Well, good morning. This is a brand new year. Amen. 2023. Praise God. Amen. Well, let's stand. Oh, I want you to shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. We got through a tough year, but praise God, we come through it because of God's grace and His power. Amen?
Amen.
And you know what? He's going to get us through 23 as well. What do you think about that?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. You know, I was praying this past week about revival, and God said, well, why don't you start one? Well, that's what I aim to do this year. We're going to start a revival. Amen?
Amen.
Even if it's just within this little circle right here. Praise God. I'm tired of being in a dry old desert. I'm looking unto God, Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, the Apostle Paul said, forget those things that are behind. That year is behind us. And press on toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So let's just keep pressing on. Let's persevere. I had a fella many years ago. He did some songs at Gogebic Medical Care. And some of you probably know him. His name is Alfie. And he'd talk about perseverance, but he used persevere. And I thought, you know, that's a good word right there. Persevere. Press into it. And that's what we need to do with this brand new year. Push into it. Amen?
Amen.
And praise God. Just kind of elbow your way through there, like that woman with the issue of blood. You know what? She said, you know, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. And she pressed all the way through that crowd. She got up there and touched Jesus. And I'll tell you something. Jesus said this. Somebody touched me. She was a nobody, an outcast. People would get around her and she'd have to say, I'm unclean, I'm unclean. Don't come near to me. But she turned out to be a somebody. And that's what you
Amen.
Are. Start pressing into Jesus Christ and you'll be somebody. Amen?
Amen?
Heavenly Father, I thank you for exhortation. I thank you for the power of your word. I thank you for the Holy Spirit who transforms our lives. And Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we just release this whole service, place it into your hands, where that you would put the sinews and the flesh and the muscle and the breath of life to it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing of Jesus Christ, the saving one. And we can see that God is moving, a mighty river through the nations, and young and old will turn to Jesus.
Yes!
Fling wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen Lord. feel the darkness tremble?
Yes.
When all the saints join in one song. That's us. Do you feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song? And all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness. And here we see that God, you're moving.
And here we see that God, you're moving.
Time.
A time of jubilee is coming.
Come on.
When young and old return to Jesus.
Yes.
Fling wide you heavenly gates. Prepare the way of the risen Lord.
Prepare the way.
Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing.
Hallelujah.
Songs that so grateful that you
Blessed be your name, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. What an awesome God we serve. What an awesome God. Faithful and true. Great and marvelous are your works, our Lord God the Almighty. Righteous and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who would not fear you and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. You alone are holy. For all the nations will come and bow before you and worship, for your righteous acts have been revealed. All hail, King Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you for what you did for us on the cross.
Its victory. The King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. Final breath and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake and the veil was torn. The sacrifice was made as the heavens rose. Thank you.
The ocean,
Praise the Lord. Glory, hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. And Lord, we lift up the banners. We let the anthems ring. Let them sing praises to the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Jesus is His name. Praise God. And Father, we just open the gates of our hearts this morning, the gates of our home, the gates of this great nation, God. We open it so that the King of glory can come in and praise God can revive us. And Father, just like Ezra said in his book, he said, Lord, give us some measure of revival. And Father, I pray this for our nation right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, that you would give us a measure of revival. God, that we would all come together in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, that we would see great and mighty things done by a mighty God who performs miracles. For we serve Him who created the heavens and the earth and all the seas and all the mountains and all the rivers, all of these things, and all the animals, and even created us. And we thank you, God, today that as we stand here as a new creation in Christ Jesus, and our testimony, God, is just exactly what it says. The testimony of the Lord makes wise the simple. Father, we thank you today for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thou mayest be seated. Hallelujah, God. And the Word of God says, this is out of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and I'm going to start with verse 16. The Word of God says, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And do not quench the Spirit. Amen. There's a lot of instruction or exhortation in that scripture. First off, he wants us to rejoice always. Fellas, you can come forward and distribute the elements this morning. First off, he says to rejoice always. And this rejoicing means to praise the Lord. It also means, I looked up that word, rejoice. And it means to spin like a top. Some of this stuff is kind of strange, but when you look at it, it makes sense. To spin like a top. In other words, you're free in the Lord. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. And he says, rejoice always. He says to pray without ceasing. You might say, well, how can I pray without ceasing? The Bible says this in many places, to continue in prayer. Pray without ceasing. And when he says this, to pray without ceasing, you might say, well, I got to work. I got to sleep. But you can be in an attitude of prayer continually and be instant in prayer, as the scripture teaches. I want to encourage you today. These three things, and this last one right here, in everything, give thanks. No matter what trial, what fiery trial you might be going through, or you might even be in right now, give thanks. I was ministering to a person this past week, and they got a problem with loneliness. And I said, you know, if you can't seem to shake it, why don't you ask God, what are you trying to teach me here? And then when you fall into God's will, His peace will be there. And your mind will be at peace as well as your heart. And I want to encourage you today, if you're going through a fiery trial, then thank God. And he says, thank God in everything. Every problem, every situation, where you are right now, in the snowbank, out of the snowbank, whatever it is, the ice broke under you and you're in the water. And it's not hot water, it's cold water. whatever you might be facing right now, give thanks and just simply say, Lord, what do you want to teach me in this situation? And you know what? That's where character comes from. That's where you'll remember how God brought you through the trial. And as you give thanks, he also says, don't quench the spirit. When you get the opportunity to give a testimony, the opportunity to share a scripture with someone, to encourage them, to pray with them, I'll tell you, don't quench the spirit. Because God is out there and he's setting you up every day. He sets you up. And when you walk by faith, I like what Denise said back in the prayer room there. She said, you know, God is, he likes spontaneity, where you just get up and just start doing something. And you know something? Many times you might just start out in the flesh, but you'll wind up in the spirit every time. Amen. I found that out many times. I want to encourage you today. Put those four things in practice. Rejoice always. And again I say rejoice. Give thanks in everything. And give thanks for everything. And he says to pray without ceasing. And whatever you do, don't quench the spirit. I pray that those scriptures will encourage you and enlighten you today. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. You know, as we receive communion this morning, this is a wonderful time to receive it. And like I mentioned before, you know, the Apostle Paul did say, forget those things that are behind and press on toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. You know, this is all the will of God. And if you're searching for the will of God, those are good places to start right there. Just forget about things. I also was reading a post that Denise put out this week. And it said, don't enter into this new year with unforgiveness. Boy, that's a good thing right there. Get rid of the unforgiveness. Forgive those that have offended you. And go on. Just leave it behind. Press on toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Praise the Lord, and you'll find out that life will be a whole lot easier, a whole lot better. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Our Heavenly Father, as we receive communion this morning, it's a blessing, God. Oh, Lord, my God, I praise you today. And God, my heart is open to you, and I pray that every heart that's here today, that they have a heart to receive the things of God, to worship you in spirit and in truth. I thank you that the windows of heaven are open now, and I praise you that the kingdom of God is within. Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, as we partake of this bread together today, we thank you for healing. I thank you for healing. I thank you for carrying our sicknesses and our diseases, our brokenness and our shortcomings, God. I thank you for that. Our insecurities, Lord, that we can just place everything into your hands and just knowing that everything's going to be all right. We can just walk away from the problems and situations, God, and let you work them out. I thank you, Lord, for all the invitations that you give in your word, and especially that one that says, come, let's reason together. Though your sins might be as scarlet, they should be whiter than snow. Thank you for that invitation. And God, I've been weary. I've been in trouble. And God, I come to you. Praise God, I found out that your burden is light. A whole lot lighter than the burdens that maybe the world or the pressures of life put on me. And I just cast that care upon you because I know that you care for me. In Jesus' name. And Father, I know that all of this was placed on Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And Father, I just thank you. As I quote this scripture, God, today, God, to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? I pray today, God, that people would receive the revelation of Jesus Christ and what he accomplished on the cross of Calvary, and that they would believe it in this whole brand new year, and that they would walk with power, the anointing of the Holy Spirit in their life, and God, that they would realize it and be aware of it. And Father, I thank you right now. And as we partake of this bread together, we thank you in Jesus' name for the price that you paid. Amen. Let's receive the bread. The scripture says that after the same manner, Jesus took the cup and he blessed this cup. And he said that this represents the new covenant. And in this new covenant are lots of brand new promises. And every one of those promises are yes and amen through Jesus Christ. And your sins are washed away because of the blood of Jesus. And in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 16 and 17, it says that he remembers your sins no more because they ain't there. They're washed away. That's good news. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much this morning. I thank you for salvation, healing, deliverance. I thank you for all my needs being met. I even thank you for snow tires, God. And in the name of Jesus, I give you the glory and honor. Amen. Let's partake of this together.
Think of a better place to be than church on the first day of the year. That's a good way to start the year, isn't it? You know, as Pastor Roy was speaking, he talked a lot about character and about rejoicing. And I was thinking about that as far as this new year is starting. You know, many of us, as we see the new year coming, we start making plans and preparations. You know, new year, new me, like trying to live your best life in 2023. And we make all these plans and these New Year's resolutions, but usually before February even starts, all these New Year's resolutions have died off. They're gone. They're done. And we've forgotten about them. And I think in order for us to begin to live that new life, and many of us have made these declarations about our relationship with God. Like, God, in 2023, I want to pray more. In 2023, I want to go deeper. In 2023, I want to hear from you more. But the struggles of our flesh and our mind often get in the way of our spiritual growth. And Paul said that in 1 Corinthians 3. He was talking to the church in Corinth, and he was saying that your struggles in the flesh are keeping you immature in your faith, to where you can only have milk, you can't have solid food yet because of your struggles of your flesh. So I think that in this year, and today being the first day of the year, we need to declare and to pray that the struggles that once held us captive in the past and kept us from growing in the past would be broken off today. So that in 2023, we can say real spiritual growth, and we can begin to step out of these fears, these anxieties, insecurities, pride, and we can live the life that God is calling us to live and fulfill the things that God is calling us to live for. So I just want to pray for us. So God, we just declare your glory today. God, I pray right now in Jesus' name, God, that you begin to break off these struggles of the flesh that are keeping people from maturing in their faith. God, this fear, timidity, God, insecurity, pride, jealousy, envy, God, all these things, Father, I pray that today, God, you would break those things off, that the things that have held people captive in the past, God, on this day, the first day of January 23, God, that in Jesus' name, God, we just declare that you break those things off, and that they really are a new them in 2023, God, because their minds are being renewed through Christ, because they're living not by their power, but by your power today. So, Father, I pray, God, that you would just empower this church today, God, to no longer to live in the struggles of the past, God, but to be overcomers in your name. to be overcomers in your power, God, to see the things that held them captive for so long broken off because they no longer trust their strength, God, they trust your strength, Lord. So today, God, we glorify your great name. We praise you for this new year, God, and we just declare that this is the year of overcoming challenges, of overcoming adversity, so that we can see spiritual success in our area, in our nation, God, because we're going to be bold in our faith, because we're not going to be held down any longer, God, but we're going to step out in your strength today, Lord. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're a family here, so I think we got to greet each other this morning. Give each other a hug, a handshake.
All right, good morning. You guys want to make your way to your seats? So glad you came to church this morning. Got to make sure this this megaphone's on. Oh, well, I'm so glad that you guys came to church this morning. Glad that you made your way after, I think we haven't been here for like 3 or 4 weeks, so it's good to see that we have basically a full house. Yeah, well, we're so glad. Pastor Todd and Robin are not here, but they send their regards. They're on vacation with their family at the Dells, and we just hope they're having a good time. I'm sure they're watching the live stream right now. But yeah, we just want to welcome you to church this morning. Those on the live stream, we welcome you too, if you tuned in. You know what? It's just a good day to be at church, because of course it's the day that the Lord's made, but ultimately it's a new year. Who's excited for a new year? Come on, come on, come on. Yeah. Come on, raise it up, raise it up. Yeah, there we go. Oh, but you know what? I was actually thinking during worship, and Josh really hit on it, is, you know, a lot of people, you know, do those like New Year's resolutions, but every time a new year comes around, this is what I think of, is it's another year for me to die to myself and let the Lord reign in me. Amen. And so that he would be glorified. And, you know, this past week, I've been thinking about this actually the past 7 days, is I've been thinking about the abundant life that the Jesus talks about in John 10. And I thought it was interesting, because, you know, it kind of hit me hard this past week, is that we can live in two worlds. We can live in the world of the miraculous, or we can live in this world of perversion or of things of not of God. And, you know, it really hit me hard this week that it's always better to live in the world of the miraculous. Mm-hmm. See signs and wonders, because we're doing the Lord's work and we're just seeing move in powerful ways. And, you know, this year I want to challenge you. Would you let your whole being, your whole mind, your whole heart, and your whole being just be devoted to him? Would that be a resolution for you today? That you would say, not my will, but Lord, your will be done. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. There we go. We got it. Oh, so we got announcements this morning. And so I just want to tell you, we're going to be starting up our Wednesday nights this coming Wednesday at 6. So kids, get ready, because we're going to have a full house. Oh, we're also selling Cornerstone sweatshirts again for the 2023. And our motto this year is All Hail King Jesus. Yes. Isn't that such a good motto? Yes. Yeah, that's a good one. So yeah, we're going to have sweatshirts for $20. They're downstairs in the big communion room. So just go down the stairs and there'll be a table there, me and Josh set up this past week. And we're also selling Cornerstone beanies.
Yay!
Now, I heard that. I think that's my kind of hat, a beanie. Yeah, so beanies are going to be about $12. So if you're interested in beanie, I believe they're going to actually be in the office. So just let one of the people here know and we'll get that for you. And so we got that going. And then we also, Denise just told me, actually, there's going to be meeting after church if you are interested in Preach Jesus 101. So I highly recommend, because we all need to be those that go out and just publicly speak him out, speak his name, tell testimonies and stories, and really tell people about the goodness of God. So if you are interested in that, I would come to the meeting after church today, and Denise will give you a rundown on all of that good stuff. And another thing that we have going is coming in June, we are taking another missions trip to Honduras, and so that's going to be the 23rd to the 30th. And I just want to tell you, this past year I went to Honduras with Josh and a couple of others, Brooke, Cal, and Blaze, and a few others. Carolyn was there, and don't want to leave you out. I rope you in, but you know, yeah, we're going to be doing a mission trip to Honduras, and I tell you what. I went this past year, and it really opened my eyes, because America, it's definitely different to go to places in Central America. And, you know, we did a bunch of stuff. We we burned out the clutch of a truck trying to get to the mountains. That was something I wasn't expecting. And I'm sure Josh wasn't expecting it too, because he was driving. But you know, we did all sorts of things. We did ministry, we got to spend time with the kids in the villages, and we did house visiting. We did a lot of manual labor. And I'm telling you what, if I really needed a workout, I was pumped by the time I came back to the States, because my arms were just pounding, and they were a little bit larger than before. And it wasn't because of food, but it was because of hard work. I remember we were pouring the sidewalk to a school up on the hill, because these kids were having to just climb up this steep terrain, and with just it not really a good thing for your feet, but maybe then it toughened them up. But no, we did. We made sidewalks. We helped with the foundation on this one home, and we did a bunch of stuff like that. But I think the most memorable experience, and really something that really hit hard for me, was the last night we went to La Ceiba, and we had this soccer game night with the youth group of the church there, with Pastor Luis and his folks. And what really got me was after we played soccer for 2 hours, and I tell you what, I thought I was going to be rusty, because I haven't played soccer since high school. And I'm like 5 years out of high school, and I'm going to tell you, I was surprised I could keep up, so I felt good about that. But you know, what really hit me hard was, you know, the team got to share our testimonies, and Josh preached that night, and what really hit home for me, we were doing prayer at the end of it, and this young man named Francisco came up, and he could really relate to my testimony. See, our testimonies have power to really minister to people. And maybe you're here and you think your testimony is not worth anything, but I'm going to tell you, it's worth something to somebody out there. And the Lord knows pretty well, because he's the one who's given you that testimony.
Amen.
And what really hit me hard is I got to pray for this young man who was just feeling beat down, because he was trying to do something good for his father that abandoned him his whole life. And his father took all his money that he worked hard to buy him this house, and he just ran off to the States, and he was just feeling wrecked. He was feeling broken, brokenhearted. And he felt the Lord speak to him that night. He's like, man, there's more that I can do for this life that I'm living. And I tell you what, when we do these missions trips, it's not about getting out of the country for 2 weeks and hanging out with people from a different nation. No, it's about ministering the gospel that is so needed in other parts of the world that, man, people need to hear that message. And so I know Josh has some things that he wants to share on that. So Josh can come up and speak that.
Yeah, so obviously you can tell just by how Nick speaks about it that it really impacted his life. And the reason that I'm really passionate about doing missions and trying to bring more missions to this church is because I started doing missions at 12 years old, and it affected my entire life. Right? So my perspective, the way I view God, the way I view ministry, the way I view people, was all affected because I went on a mission trip at 12 years old. Right? And who would take a 12-year-old to the middle of nowhere in Honduras? My dad. Like, it's crazy. It doesn't make any sense. But like Nick said, like, it's such a lifelong impact. And the thing is, you go down there and with the expectation to serve the people, but God ends up like just changing your heart more than you probably think you've changed others. So it's a lifelong impact. So next Sunday after the service, we'll have a meeting. I'll answer any questions you have. We'll talk about finances, kind of logistics, what would happen on the trip. And if you just feel God just itching at your ear right now, then I really suggest that you go, because it probably means that you're supposed to go, right? Because most of the time, that fear, that timidity, that fear of going out of the country really hinders us from really being changed in that way. So if you really feel strongly that that's what you're supposed to do, I just really encourage you that you need to go. You need to go. So we're so excited to be able to do that with Frontline again, and I can't wait to see the lifelong impact that it'll make on people here, but also as we continue to join with Frontline and the community over there, and just the way we're really partnering with churches around the world. It's so exciting, because God is worldwide. God is not just in Ramsey. God is worldwide. We need to connect and support churches worldwide, and I'm just so excited to be a part of that. So our ushers are going to come forward now to do the offering, and then we have a special treat today. During our offering, Denise and Bob have put together another wonderful skit. Based on their acting on Family Sunday, I just am giddy about what's about to happen. All right, Jeff, would you like to pray for us?
Oh, I would love to. And Father God, we just thank you for this day, this new year.
You say no day is promised, but yet we are here right now, and you are with us, and we just thank you for that. Just ask that you would receive these offerings and tithes, and Lord, do miraculous things with them. You are free to do what you need to do, and we just praise you for all that you do and all the blessings you do pour down upon us. So we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
So
it's mine because it's so short.
Yeah, that's yours. No.
They already got me set up for the microphone. Perfect.
So far, so good. All right, so this is the other day. It's 2 days ago. I was in prayer. And the thing about what the Lord is doing through, it's called soaking or whatever, but I call it garden time with the Lord every morning and just soak in his presence. And it's been over the last 2 years, it's been like he's like opening up a fire hose of creativity on me. And so I'm not going to want to stop it. So I'm just going to thank you for your patience today. And we're going to, this is a word from the Lord is what I'm trying to say. Okay, so it's called I'm Traveling Light. If the year 2023 was an airplane flight, what kind of baggage would you bring with you? Welcome to Holy Spirit Air Flight 2023. We are now boarding. Please bring any bags that need to be checked at this time. Welcome, sir. I hope you're having a fabulous day. What kind of baggage do you have?
I just have this really big suitcase, and I don't know. I don't want to let it go, to be honest. I got my ticket. I've been carrying it through the airport. Well, actually, I've been dragging it through the airport, just hoping that it will fit in the overhead compartment. But it's pretty heavy, as you can see. In fact, I'm super nervous about this flight. No, nervous really isn't the word. I'm terrified to fly or go anywhere. I don't know what's wrong with me, but I'm afraid to let this luggage out of my sight.
Oh, but sir, this bag of fear is much too big and bulky for the overhead. That will be $500 to check it. May I have your credit card, please? You can pick up your suitcase at the end of your flight at baggage claim. Your name is on it. So please try to enjoy your flight, sir. You can leave that right here, because we got to check it.
I'll leave my fear.
And you're $500.
I'll leave my fear right
there. Next, please. You can take that right off the stand and put it to your mouth there.
So I've been carrying this gigantic bag. It feels like all my life, well, since 2007. It's heavy, and at times somewhat tormenting. I haven't spoken to my family in all these years. Boy, I've sure shown them. The problem is, I'm alone and miserable. On the other hand, I've been carrying it so long now, I guess it's kind of a comfort. The pain is on. So I keep carrying it around, everywhere I go, year after year. See, my name is permanently marked on it already. I'd really much rather keep it close to me if possible. Will it fit in the overhead?
No, ma'am, I'm sorry. The bag of unforgiveness will have to be put in the category with large things. It's so heavy that it will actually be, we're gonna have to use it to balance the weight of the entire aircraft. unfortunately, you might need to take out a small loan to cover this one. Rest assured, we'll take care of this bag for you, but if you should choose not to claim it after your flight, that would be better for you in the long run, and it would certainly go far in mending those relationships. Would you like to check it for $5,000? Or would you rather not take it with you?
You know, that's a lot of money. I think it's time that I let this go. Jesus forgave me, and I should forgive others. I want to leave it right here. And will you dispose of it for me?
Yes, absolutely. That's a great plan. Because of your choice to forgive, I have been authorized to bump you up to first class for the entire flight. At Holy Spirit Air, we love to lighten your load. We would be glad to take care of that for you. Enjoy your flight. Perfect. Okay, and yes, so just so you all know, from this point on, that fear, unforgiveness, pride, anger, condemnation, shame, and other large things
will absolutely need to be checked and placed in the belly of this airplane. Bags that will fit in the overhead compartment are regret, doubt, laziness, procrastination, bitterness, self-righteousness, selfishness, and the like. And while they will fit in the cabin, if there is any turbulence, they will probably spill out onto the heads of the other passengers. So since these bags are toxic to everyone, we will need to charge a toxic fee for those things. This is the last call, now boarding Holy Spirit Air Flight 2023. Ticket, please. Sir, thank you. Do you have any bags to check?
Nope. All I have is this Jesus backpack that I wear wherever I go. You would be amazed at how much I can fit into this bag. It's a life preserver. It's got a parachute. I have bread of life, living water, eternal life, and a super bright flashlight. I've got some clothes of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, all folded up nicely in there. And my favorite outfit for special occasions is love and the Lord Jesus Christ. This Jesus backpack has got 9 kinds of fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. And even some gifts from God, like discernment, words of wisdom, and knowledge. It's got GPS, God's positioning of the Savior. So I always know the way, and there's so much more. But the best part is the present of His presence, because He's always with me and promised never to leave me. And all of this is in my Jesus backpack. So no, I won't be checking any baggage, because on flight 2023, I'm traveling light.
Sweet. All right, so in the year 2023, if the year 2023 was an airplane flight, what kind of baggage will you be bringing?
Are we blessed with some really creative people at this church? Just give a hand to Denise for just listening to God. That was super good. All right, so right now we're going to release our 3 to 6-year-olds to go downstairs. 3 to 6-year-olds. I remembered releasing the kids this week. I call that a win. Usually I forget. Well, like Nick said, today's kind of a different Sunday. We don't have one person speaking. We have multiple people speaking. Because we're doing this, Pastor Todd called it Faithfulness in 5, which is people just sharing their testimony in 5 minutes. And if you don't know what a testimony is, it's you testifying how God has impacted your life. And there's so much power to that. And the reason that there's power to it is, I don't know if you've ever tried to like argue Christianity with someone who like wasn't having it, but it is difficult. They can come up with scientific reasons, of psychological reasons, of all the things that makes God not exist, or the reason that Christianity is false. But one thing people cannot argue with is how God impacted your life. They can't argue with the changes that happened. They can't argue with depression and fear that is gone, or addiction that was broken because of the power of Christ in your life. They can't argue with that, because it's your story, and it's the way that God has worked in your heart. And so that's why sharing your testimony is so powerful. But the thing is, in order for people to know that story, you have to tell it. You have to proclaim it. You have to share your testimony with those around. Amen. It's kind of like this morning, a lot of people approached me about a certain game that was played yesterday. Now, I promised Cal I wasn't going to talk about how Georgia won in the last minute of the game, how at the 58-second mark of the fourth quarter that Georgia scored the winning touchdown. I'm not going to talk about that, right? I'm not. Although I do probably have to confess, Jeffrey last night was asking me, they were kicking a field goal, Ohio State was kicking the field goal to beat George in the game, and Jeffrey's like, Josh, are you okay with praying about field goals missing? And I told like a half lie. I said, no, Jeffrey, I don't pray about that kind of stuff. But in my head, I was like, God, I'm not going to pray about this, but it'd be really good if they did miss this field goal. So I just want to confess that in front of the church, get that off my chest. But what's crazy is, right, so we had a huge football games yesterday. The college playoffs happened yesterday. They had 2 winners, and then next week is the finals. But 2 weeks ago was the biggest sporting event in the world, right? One of the biggest, the most watched sporting event happened 2 weeks ago. And I can almost guarantee that nobody in here watched it. 2 weeks ago, one of the greatest athletes in the world made his final crowning achievement that ever happened for his career. And this guy has an amazing story. He grew up in a small town. His father was just a factory worker. He wasn't anything special, but he was an amazing athlete for his sport. And they saw potential in him. And he actually had a really bad, I think it was like a growth defect to where he wasn't growing properly. And they were having to pay like thousands of dollars. And his family couldn't afford to pay for this anymore. And so this team saw that he had great potential in the sport. And so they moved him to the city and they paid for all his medical stuff. And they just really invested into him as an athlete. And he had greatly shown that he was worth it all. He's achieved everything in his sport you could possibly achieve. He's known as one of the greatest athletes in the world. But most of you have no idea who I'm talking about. His name is Lionel Messi, right? Some of you still don't know who I'm talking about. And last week, he won the World Cup for his country. So he literally has won everything possible in his sport that he could win. Awards, achievements, championships, he's won everything. But his story doesn't impact you because none of you have ever heard his story before. None of you can relate to soccer in the way that other people in Hispanic countries can relate or around the world can relate, right? Because his story is unique to a different kind of culture than what we're used to in the United States. And that's the same with your testimony. Your testimony has great power, and it's going to impact a certain group of people that have been through similar things to what you have been through. But that can only impact them is if you begin to share your testimony. Because your testimony, like Nick said, it's powerful. It's impactful. It can change people around you because they can see how God has worked in your life and say, man, I really struggle with that same stuff. I came from a similar background. I had similar struggles. So if you can do it through Christ, maybe I should try Christ too. That's what happens when we begin to share a testimony. And so this morning we have four people sharing their testimony, and I just believe that this is going to be a powerful time. And so our first person, everybody was fighting with me about who could go first. Literally every single one of them, except I think Peter asked me to go first. But I think Bo had a tear in his eye when he asked me, so I'm going to let Bo go first. No, Bo didn't have a tear in his eye. So Bo's been with us, has it been a month?
Yes.
Around a month. And we're just so blessed. Bo lives across the street at the Hope House. And we're just excited to hear his testimony.
Amen. I'm going to raise this up. You got to get real close to it. So greetings, my brothers and sisters in Christ. First, I want to bless our Heavenly Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit that dwells in each one of us. Second, I pray that you all had a very safe and joyful Christmas. So my name is Bo Menara, and this is my testimony. I've been living over at the Hope House. So the question was asked of me, what does the new year represent for me? And as I sat on my bed at the Hope House thinking about this, I had a revelation about death, rebirth, renewal, and hope, and how this relates to my testimony. You see, from our Lord Jesus' crucifixion, we who believe and trust in him put to death our very sinful nature, and we are reborn, renewed, and very hopeful in Christ our Savior as we wait patiently for God's promises to be fulfilled. You know, as I thought about giving my testimony, I kind of chuckled when Pastor Todd asked if I could keep it under 5 minutes. You see, I've been through so much in 42 years that if I truly went into detail about all the hurt, trauma, and devastation I've been through, I don't think 5 hours would suffice. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go down the list of some of the things that the devil has tried to throw at me to steal, destroy, and kill my life. But for the sake of time, I'm only going to focus on 2 major turning points of my life. And at the end, I'll explain why I put my faith and trust in Jesus. So let's get started. I was born 6 weeks premature, and that of itself ain't that unusual. But I was also born breached. And some of you women parents know that if you're breached, you were born feet first. And that of itself ain't that unusual, but I came out with the umbilical cord wrapped around my neck. You know, when I first found this out, I kind of joked around and said, I didn't even want to be born into this evil world. I've been through 2 house fires, in one of which we barely made it out, me, my brother, my sister, and my mom and dad, we barely made it out because the roof collapsed in the front porch. Then I almost drowned three times as a toddler, once in the river right behind us. Then I was also molested as a little boy by a family member. So next is the first major turning point in my life, my father's suicide. I was only 6 years old when my dad decided to take his life. I remember I was so hurt, so angry, so devastated to think that if my dad could care so little about his life, why should I care about mine? So I decided to look elsewhere to fill that void. First, I tried video games, then I turned to alcohol, then I engaged in sex before settling on drugs. For over 20 years, I shot up dope almost daily, sometimes multiple times a day. Then in 2007, I contracted HIV from a dirty needle. I was lost out there in the wilderness, becoming more and more depressed. Then my mother passed away in 2011, and I was homeless, having to break into abandoned buildings just to have a roof over my head, and that's when I hit rock bottom. And that's when that part of my life died. Now comes the rebirth, renewal, and hope, and the second major turning point of my life. So there I found myself locked up in the county jail, going through severe withdrawals and scared to death about going to prison. When a friend of mine, who I haven't seen in a long time, showed up to visit, he told me that they had this Bible ministry group that came to the jail called Cornerstone and how it helped him. So I decided to go, and I went again the next week. Then weeks turns into months, and it was Easter Sunday, and that Easter Sunday happened to land on April Fool's Day. And I'll never forget that day, because at the end of that visit by Pastor Todd and Jack, may Jack rest peacefully, I surrendered my life over to Jesus and accepted his gift of salvation. That was the day that God said to me, "Stop following Satan. He is a liar and a fool. You are my son. Amen. Come follow me." Now you're probably wondering, why did I bring up all this hurt and trauma to a room full of strangers? Well, because none of us in this room are strangers. We are brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. And second, we shouldn't be afraid to talk to each other about these things. We have to expose our difficulties and our past traumas to the light so they can begin to heal. Because if we keep it bottled up, it'll eventually rot away and infect our souls. Plus, we serve an all-loving and compassionate Lord who loves to take things that we would consider beyond repair and not only restore them, but make them better than when he first received it. And if we truly walk in the light as he is in the light, not only will we have fellowship with each other, but that's when we truly begin to heal. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Wow, what a powerful testimony. All right, so next we have Claire. We're just so blessed to have Claire here today. She's such a blessing to our church. You can use either one you want.
Hello, everyone. I'm honored to be asked to do this and humbled, and I thank the Lord that I'm standing here today. Thank you, Bob, for being a hard act to follow. Is this coming through? Is this working?
Okay.
Closer to the mouth. Okay, so last summer I attended the Vacation Bible School for the first time in my life, and I went there, I thought, to help kids get closer to Jesus. Well, it turned out that I was also part of the plan there, because as we were standing around, the adults were talking while the kids were doing some activity, and Denise looks at me and says, "So when did you accept Christ as your Savior?" And I kind of looked at her like, I'm not really sure if I have or when I did, and that sort of started this whole thing. And she said, well, we're going to go to have lunch after vacation Bible school. And we found ourselves sitting and eating pasties at Randall Bakery. And Denise, in her inimitable way, started asking me a lot of questions and being curious as she is. And it occurred to me that I did need to take that step and really solidify my relationship with Jesus. But it also, I was aware when she asked me those questions that he's been with me my whole life, despite everything. As a child, I knew him, and he was part of my life for sure. I was raised in a family that was faithful at first. In my family, my parents were both believers, and they were raised by very faithful people. But when I was a child, something happened about the age of 7. You know, I don't know how many of you have actually seen The Wizard of Oz. I know it's an old movie, but I do recommend those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, go back and watch the old version of the movie. But that movie, when I was a kid, just scared me really deep. It was the scariest movie. You think any of this new stuff is scary? That's a scary movie. And what happened to my family was like that tornado that came in and just lifted up the house and spun it around and dropped it down in this weird place. And that's kind of what happened in the late 60s in this country. My father started to drink a lot and became very alcoholic, used all kinds of drugs, and you know, all kinds of craziness ensued. The culture of the 60s, the politics took over, and religion was out the door. We were just not going to church anymore, and everything became a really strange, strange world. My brothers, I have 4 brothers, and they were wild, and I tried to keep up with them, and I tried to do everything that they did, which was a bad idea, very bad idea. Once I asked my mom later in life, I said, Mom, why did you let us do all that stuff? And she said, well, that's just what everybody was doing then. And that was a very bad answer. And it's always a bad answer to follow what everybody else is doing, because we, all of us, I'm so grateful. I'm grateful to God that my brothers and I are still alive. I won't go into detail, but it was not good what we were doing. Very, very risky and good, not good behavior. We were, my father started to become abusive and had violent rages and tore up our house and attacked us and our mother. And it was a very terrible, terrible time. I think about that movie, The Wizard of Oz, and how Dorothy was just by herself in this strange land trying to go down this golden, the yellow brick road, and you're supposed to go find this wizard who's going to help you find your way back home again. And that was me. I was just going down this road that promised all kinds of things that weren't going to happen. She finally gets to that wizard, those of you who know the movie, and he sends her off. He pretends to be this powerful thing and sends her off on a terrible mission to kill a witch. And she gets captured by evil flying monkeys. It's terrible. Those monkeys haunted me. I had nightmares for all my childhood about those flying monkeys. And then she finally gets back to the wizard and finds out he's a fraud. He's just a big fake, just like everything in the culture that tries to draw us and suck us into its distractions and its destruction and everything else. And at that point, you know, she finally realizes that she has had what it takes to get home the whole time on her feet, the ruby slippers. They are on her feet. And that was with her. The key she needed to get back to her home was with her the whole time. And that's how it was when Denise asked me that question of, where's the Lord in your life? And how, what's your relationship? I kind of, in a way, I looked down and I went, yeah, I've had them all along. He's been with me my whole life. He's been there. I loved Easter when I was a little kid. I kept a palm branch that I got for Easter. I kept it all my childhood. I had that palm branch just dried up, and for some reason, it was something that meant so much to me. I knew that Jesus rose from the dead. I knew that he lived and that he was part of the world, still alive in the world. When we came here, when we found our way here, Well, first, I just want to say that in my life in Madison, I was teaching. I taught in Madison schools for 30 years, and it became clear to me that what was happening there was taking people off on a bad direction. I was seeing my friends' children getting swept up into gender ideology and transgenderism, and a lot of things started to become clear to me that it just wasn't right. And I'll credit Pete, my wonderful husband, for helping me start to see the reality in front of me that I had accepted so long, the politics of leftism and the culture. And I started to see more clearly that that wasn't leading anyone in a good place, into a good direction. And then when Pete and I adopted our beautiful girls, I think becoming a mother was a huge eye-opener. Just everyone here who's a parent knows that it really starts to clarify things in your life. So we ended up here, and we wanted to find a church, and we started to search around the area. And only when our neighbor, Alicia, told us about Cornerstone did we find this amazing place. And it was like in The Wizard of Oz, again, go see the movie, when Dorothy finally gets home and she wakes up from that nightmare and she looks around and sees the people she loves and says, you're there, Auntie Em, you're there. And it was like that, coming to Cornerstone. I felt like I was waking up from a nightmare and seeing you people and seeing Pastor Todd and Robin. Hi, I hope you're watching. Pastor Todd and Robin, and they're all just such incredible big hearts and wonderful, and Pastor Roy, and of course Denise. And the first time we came, and Denise was just singing, and Pete said, I couldn't believe the look on your face, and you were crying. And yeah, I didn't even think I liked praise music. Praise the Lord. Praise. Thank you, Denise. And Pastor Josh, who came along and helped our children and is there for our kids and helping, teenagers need all the help they can get, right? So having these people and having the Genesots and their amazing ministry and what they're doing for people here and the camp, I just can't say enough about what's going on here. And our plumbing gave out this spring, and there were Jim Bale and Annette there with their backhoe just spending days helping us. And I'm like, believe this. It's just an amazing community, the kingdom of God. Thank you. And the women's Bible study and the men's Bible study and just everyone, Tammy and her wonderful home and her life ring that she invited us into. I just can't be grateful enough. I'm sorry, I feel like I've spoken now for about an hour. I just want to say thank you. And now that I'm here, the Lord has plans, and I know that. I don't know what they are, but I'm open, and I'm willing and faithful, and I'm looking forward to the new year. I'm looking forward to the new year in the kingdom and what we can do together at Cornerstone and beyond. And thank you all.
Amen. Yes.
What a great story. Amen. And we're just so blessed with the people we have in this church. Claire shows up week after week just serving in every way she can. So next we have Justin. Now, Justin got saved like a year ago. I don't want to steal too much of his thunder, but I'm going to brag on him a little bit. I'm so proud of Justin and the man he is and just all his talents and giftings and just the way he's grown just in a year. We're so blessed to have you here, Justin.
So I actually just wanted to read a little bit of scripture before I start. From 1 Peter chapter 1, 3 through 7. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. So I just wanted to share that because not only do our trials bring us to Jesus, but the trials also strengthen us, strengthen our faith in Jesus, which is of greater worth than gold. So I agreed to do this in the hopes our Lord may be glorified in his unfailing grace, love, power, and forgiveness for all those who seek and accept him. I did not grow up in the church, but I prayed to God my whole life whenever things got bad. It seems weird, but even without understanding who Jesus is, I still prayed. Without understanding the life in which he calls us to live, I did my own thing out of ignorance. I was met with emptiness and fleeting moments of happiness. I tried seeking the fulfillment I desired in sports, getting in good shape, having a girlfriend, partying, drinking, drugs. Everything that was bringing me further from the Lord, I was doing in the search for the fulfillment that I didn't know existed from Jesus. It came to the point where I was so depressed, I wanted to end my life. One night when I was in college, over 3 years ago now, sick of the depression and the belief of the lie that I was unworthy to be alive, at night I walked to the local gas station and bought some sort of sleeping pills and I took them. That night was very cold and I went out in the snow and I eventually just passed out there. Then I opened my eyes. I can only explain this to be the Lord awakening me. I was staring up at a single star and these words were spoken to my heart, not audibly but internally. These words, with how depressed I was for 2 years, could not have been fabricated by my own mind because I had given up all hope. The Lord told me, the joy that you feel so void of right now, you can have again. You just need to get up. When I was receiving this, I was filled with this feeling of love, peace, and hope. This feeling of everything will be okay.
Amen.
I kept hearing that. Get up, get up, get up. So I did. Not really knowing what was going on, I stumbled back to my dorm and went to sleep. And you'd think, after this encounter, I'd be on fire for seeking the will of the Lord, but I was still ignorant. This is when I got into philosophy, psychology, and reading books on Stoicism. I learned a lot of self-help things, but lived life still empty and without purpose. Things went on like that for a little while, until I was invited to a service where Bob Genesot would give a message, and before it even started, I had this peace about being there. I remember telling Sandra when I walked in that I needed this. I started reading a lot, mainly in the New Testament, and really learning about Jesus for the first time. Started learning about how he calls us to live our lives, how the only way to have life is through faith in Jesus and to have a relationship with him. The Lord delivered me from every lie, from Satan, and I was born again. Seeking the Lord's will is what brings me peace in this life, and knowing Jesus is what brings me peace about the next life. It's amazing the things the Lord has shown me by seeking him, shaping and molding me due to my surrender and acceptance of Jesus. I was dead in my sins, with a hardened heart, with an arrogance and an ignorance, thinking I had the answers. Jesus is the answer, and the only one that gives me purpose and fulfillment. Jesus accepted me. He saved me and has shown me the love of our Father has by giving over his Son, who knew no sin, to die in my place. I'll forever praise the Lord. Thank you.
That's awesome.
We're so blessed with our just community of young guys at this church. Pray for us, though. Tomorrow, we're leaving at 4 a.m., and we're driving 17 hours to Atlanta to be a part of a conference down there for the week. So pray for me, especially, that I don't lose my temper or kill one of them. I don't want to name names, but Nick. But no, we're going to have a good time. We're just so blessed by Justin and just the life he's living now. So last up, we got Peter. So Peter's just such a great guy. I mean, just always willing to serve. He showed up out of nowhere like a couple months ago and has just served and served. I'm going to brag on him. Yesterday, I went to the gym. And I've been talking to Peter. Peter was a personal trainer forever, and he was yoked back in the day. Let me tell you. He showed me, still yoked. Yeah, look at him. But he's like leaving the gym as I'm coming in. He's like, hey, do you want me to train you for the next hour and a half? And I was like, I'm not going to turn that down. So he took time out of his day to just show me how to work out for an hour and a half. And I was so blessed by it.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you, everybody. Happy New Year, first of all. Happy New Year to everyone. I want to begin by saying that today marks my second year of sobriety. Today. Thank you. But all of that applause, it doesn't belong to me. All of that belongs to Jesus, right? It is a miracle. So when I was praying in preparation to read my testimony, initially, the Holy Spirit was telling me not to read anything from a piece of paper. And I was like, what? I want to read like something that's really well written. But I'm learning now as I'm getting older, and this will go into my testimony, that when the Holy Spirit tells me to do something, I need to listen to it, right? Yeah. Right? So I'm going to begin by, it's hard too, and first of all, I want to thank everybody who's come up to share their testimony today. It's really hard to get in front of a group of people, share personal, painful stories about your life. Thank God we have such a great congregation where there's so much love, compassion, and empathy that you should feel comfortable sharing anything on this stage. So I'm going to start from the beginning, and I'm going to try to fast forward through certain sections because I am 51 years old. So if I told my whole story, we'd be here for a really long time. But I was abandoned by my biological parents when I was 2 years old. I was found on a train in Seoul, Korea, left all by myself. All that I had with me were the clothes that I was wearing and a little piece of scrap paper pinned to my shirt with a diaper pin. And on that piece of paper was the name that I was born with, Kim Chul-ung. Now, in Korea, if you were abandoned and left in a public place, that was against the law. So my biological parents were really doing something, you know, illegal by leaving me there on the train. So I believe that was the first miracle that God had provided to me in my life, with a family that was humble enough to know that they were not going to be able to care for me. I was super sick. The odds of me surviving, maybe 50-50. So the people that found me, the authorities that worked on the train, found me, and they took me to an orphanage in Korea. And for 2 years, I lived in that orphanage, and I can't remember anything about it. I've spoken to a psychologist before, and they tell me because of the trauma that occurred, my mind has kind of blocked that out. So at the age of 4, unbeknownst to me, halfway around the world, my mom, who would eventually become my mother, was praying vehemently with the women that she went to church with that they could find and adopt a Korean child and bring him to America. And I was that child. I was the first Korean boy in that orphanage to be brought through this company to the United States. There's a picture of me, and I'll show everybody one day with my little traditional bowl haircut, two American flags. I was like, oh, look at me. Great picture, and I will share it with everybody. So when I was growing up, there were no other Asian people in my neighborhood. I didn't see another Asian person in school till I was like in middle school. Like, I thought literally I was the last of the Mohicans. Nobody. I could ride my bike an hour in any direction, north, south, east, or west, and there were no Asian people. Right? So now that I'm older and being in the UP, there aren't a lot of Koreans here either. But it's a lot different. Now that I'm older, I'm more confident, and there's so many great people here. But when I was younger, that was hard, right? Everybody around me was tall, like really nice skin, you know, blue eyes. I was like, oh man, I wish I looked like that. I was super short, I had a bowl haircut, I had slanted eyes. So I remember vividly going into the bathroom, and I would sit and I would stare and look at myself, and I would do this, right? I was trying to make my eyeballs round because I didn't want slanted eyes. So obviously that didn't work. But I felt really lonely. I felt very afraid, I felt very ugly. I felt very uncomfortable in my own skin. Fast forward and moving, but you know, thank God I was given a home that was loving, compassionate. At home, I never looked at myself like I was different. My parents were so loving and so generous. They spanked me the same way they spanked my white, you know, sisters. But I was really, really blessed to have an amazing Christian home. My mother was the first example of Christian faith manifest in a person. She was an amazing person, not only because of what she did for me at the start of my life, but for what she has done for so many people over the course of her life. God rest her soul. So, you know, with a choppy childhood, but pretty much pretty happy in all regards, I grew up. But at about 18 years old, this is when things really started to change. I didn't find this out until I was an adult, but now things are beginning to make sense as I look back retrospectively. My mother discovered that my father was sexually abusing my sister for many years. There was an absence, excuse me, I knew this was going to happen. There was an absence in my life for a long time. You know, that father figure that you're supposed to have to guide you and encourage you, to teach you the difference between right and wrong. Well, I didn't have that. And there was a big, big hole in my heart. So when my parents got divorced, I was still a junior in high school. And I decided, oh, I've already figured it out. I know exactly how to live. I know exactly what I need to make it through in this world. So at, I don't know how old I was. How old are you as a junior? 17 years old? So at 17, I moved out on my own with my friend Lance. His dad had a house, and we rented his house, and all we had to do was clean the house and take care of the yard, and we could live there. So we were the only high school students in all of Fresno that lived on their own, right? So obviously, we were throwing crazy parties. Everybody was coming to our house all the time. I was drinking on a daily basis by the time I was 19 years old. We had a liquor store around the corner from where I lived that would sell to anybody, even a short dude like me. Like, if you're going to sell alcohol to me at 18, something is wrong. But he didn't care, unfortunately. So I was drinking on a daily basis from the time I was 18, smoking marijuana every day. So I had my first DUI when I was 21 years old. I overdosed on cocaine the very next year. I was experimenting with hallucinogenic mushrooms, LSD, hash, following a band called the Grateful Dead. At the time, I was really proud of it. I had long hair when I used to have hair. I drove a little Volkswagen microbus. My girlfriend was a ballet teacher. And we were just living like two really happy hippies. I thought, right, all we did is get high, go to concerts, and we thought that that was what life was all about. I quickly learned that that was not what life is all about. I've had multiple DUIs over the course of my life. I've had a terrible methamphetamine problem that absolutely stole my spirit and a large part of my life. I've lost every good friendship due to alcohol. Every girlfriend that I've broken up with is because of alcohol and or drugs. I've lost a great dream job that I had after graduating from UCLA because of alcohol. And it's absolutely stolen and marred my life. So I began to realize that I hate being alone. Being alone for me for so long in my life was terrible. My mind would just race around with all of these terrible ideas. You know, you're not worthy. Shame would just continually remind me of all the things I had done in my past. Fear of what I'm going to do next would just keep me restricted from doing anything positive. So this is how God's sense of humor works, right? I never left California. For 49 years, I lived in California, pretty much in the same beach communities my whole life. I hated being alone, and I had never been sober before. So what does God tell me to do? Sell all your stuff, go travel by yourself, and get sober. What? I was like, that doesn't sound like a good idea, right? But I sold everything that I owned. I put it in a real tiny little Kia Forte. If you ever want to see my car, walk over to the garage at the Hope House and take a look. You'd be like, what? He lived in that?
Small.
It's small. Thank you, Bo. And then I began the adventure of a lifetime, right? So what I thought was initially going to happen was this. I was going to travel to every national park in the lower 48 states. And I was getting really close to the completion of my goal. I hit 38 states, 43 national parks, and 56 state parks, pretty much camping the entire time. I stayed in 12 hotels over the course of a 1.5 year period. I saw some of the most amazing creations that God has put onto this earth for us to enjoy. His creativity and imagination was on display everywhere I went, and it was absolutely incredible. I began to realize the reason he asked me to travel alone is so that he and I could spend time with one another without the distractions of the world. And each day that went by when I was sober, I became so much closer to him, right? All those chains that had kept me burdened down for so long were finally broken.
Amen.
Right?
Yes. Amen. Alcohol, marijuana, cocaine, methamphetamines, caffeine, nicotine, hallucinogens. No wonder I can't believe I can still speak clearly to this day. My brain should be like an addled mess, right? That's only the Lord. That the Lord is making my brain still work today. I have no idea how it's going on. So then when I got to the border of Massachusetts and New Hampshire, something amazing happened. I was going to do my laundry, and Jesus was waiting for me in the parking lot of a laundromat. I didn't know he was going to be there. I was sitting minding my own business in my car, waiting for my clothes to dry, and this really nice couple came up to me and asked me if I was from California, because they had noticed my license plate. I got out of my car, and I said yes, and we started having a conversation. Within the expanse of about a five-minute conversation, I spoke Jesus' name out loud for the first time in 30 years.
Wow, praise God.
And as soon as I spoke his name aloud, the Holy Spirit began to move clearly and powerfully in my body. So when we said goodbye, I went back to my Airbnb. I got down on my knees, and I prayed for the first time in as many years, 30 years. All of the fear, the shame, anxiety, what that I had been feeling, all of that was lifted off of me immediately and miraculously. Amen. A changed person with that prayer. The very next day, I went out and I bought my first Bible. Other Bibles had been given to me in my life by people who are important and wanted me to get onto that spiritual path. This was the first one I ever purchased on my own. The next day, I went 1 hour to find a church, and I went to my first church service in as many years. All of this was happening over the course of 3 days. So on the fourth day, I got down on my knees again in my tent, and I prayed to the Lord. I said, "What do you want me to do, and where do you want me to go?" Slowly fell asleep, and in the morning, the answer was revealed to me. I met somebody last year. I'm not going to say his name, but I met him last year, and he needed a little ministering. So I was in New Hampshire, and that was going to take about 5 or 6 states to get through. I packed up my stuff that day and started moving. It took me about 4 days, 4 hotels, and about, 8 hours a day traveling to get back here. Now, this is just as the winter was beginning, right? I was like, what? Why do you always take me to the cold places? But that's what God wanted me to do. After ministering to my friend, I Googled where the nearest church was. Guess what the nearest church was? Cornerstone Church. I was like, 3 minutes away? Ooh, great. So, 3-minute drive from where I was to here. The very first person I met was Pastor Todd. Amen. I had prayed to God that I meet a pastor and a church that was filled with the Holy Spirit that I could immediately become an active member of, and this is where he put me.
Amen.
That is not a coincidence. That is divine intervention. I told Pastor Todd that I was going to try to camp over at Alpine Campgrounds over the course of the wintertime. And he looked at me kind of like this. Like, really? I know you're from California, but that's a really bad idea. So this is only the second time I'd ever met Pastor Todd. And he said, "Oh no, Pete, why don't you just stay at the Hope House? It's right across the street." He told me the story about the house. And I was like, wow, that is amazing. I absolutely thank God. And so my tent got absolutely crushed by the snow. And the next day I was living in the Hope House. So thank God for that too. So now that I've realized that God delivered me here, now what do I do, right? So all of us have a specific talent. Many of us, a lot of you in this room, have multiple talents. I believe that God has given me the talent to encourage and motivate people in a variety of different ways, through personal training, through just being with them as a friend, being on stage sharing my testimony. But that's what I'm going to do. God has put me here in the UP at Cornerstone Church to help and encourage and motivate other people just by being with you and sharing the fellowship of Christ. My New Year's resolution for 2023, in everything that I think, decide, and do, I'm going to bring glory to his name. Thank you very much.
Tell you, we're a blessed church.
Yes, we are.
We are so blessed to have people like Peter, like Justin, like Claire, like Bo at our church. Amen. And it makes our church so much better. And if each one of us came up and we shared our testimony today, like, you could look at it and be like, wow, they're so different. But at the core of it all, it's all the same. We were messed up before Christ, we found Christ, and our life was completely restored. And so if you're watching online, you're here today, and you think that you're too far gone, that you've wasted too much of your life, that God doesn't love you, I just want to tell you that's not true. Like, today is the day for new beginnings. It's the first day of the year.
Hey, so
today is the day for fresh starts. Today is the day for redemption. Today is the day for a new life. And you know, so many of you, you're listening to this testimony, you're like, wow, that's so powerful. But each one of you has a powerful testimony. But it's only powerful if you share it. And I just want to give you just a quick three-step process to sharing your testimony. And I really encourage you guys to really join that Denise's Preach Jesus, because that will take it a step further. But I'm going to give you just a really practical three-step process of sharing your testimony. What was life like before Jesus? How did you encounter Jesus to change your life? And what's life like now that you have Jesus? Just those, if you can answer those three questions in the span of 4 and 5 minutes, like, you're going to impact lives around you. You're going to see people change, because your story is going to connect with people, and they're going to be like, man, like, if you did that, I can do that too. And then we're going to see the kingdom grow and lives changed. So our worship team is going to come up now, wherever they are. And then also our prayer team is going to come up. And if you really feel like stirred in your heart, just to be prayed for, whether to be empowered, to rededicate your life, and to start a fresh new beginning today, I just really encourage you just to come up for prayer. So our prayer team is going to be up here. If everybody just wants to stand up, prayer team, if you guys want to come forward. And then if you just want prayer to seek new life, to see new beginnings, to see your life be used in a powerful way, I just really encourage you guys just to come up for prayer.
Bring restoration. You bring restoration. You bring restoration to my soul. You bring restoration. Bring restoration, my God. You bring restoration to my soul. You've taken my life. Call me by a new name. In my shame, in this place, you give me joy.
Taking my pain,
taking my pain.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Call me by a new name. Taking my take my morning and turn it into dancing. You take my weeping and you turn it into laughing. You take my mourning and you turn it into dancing, Jesus. You take my sadness and you turn it into joy. You take my mourning, God, and you turn it dancing. You take my weeping and you turn it into laughing. You take my mourning and you turn it into dancing. You take my sadness and you turn it into joy. Restoration. bring restoration. Oh my God, bring restoration, Jesus, to my soul. Bring restoration. Bring restoration. Only you can do this, Lord. You bring restoration. You restore my soul. You bring restoration. To my soul. Take my morning and you turn it into dancing. Take my morning and you turn it into dancing. You take my weeping and you turn it into laughing. Oh Lord, you take my morning and you turn it into dancing. You take my sadness and you turn it into joy. You take my morning, Jesus, and turn it into dancing. You take my weeping, God, and you turn it into laughing. You take my mourning and you turn it into dancing, Lord. You take my sadness and you turn it into joy.